All right, we got everybody blacked out. Thank you guys all so much for coming. Huge crowd, almost 400 folks. Thank you for all coming out. We got four great VCs who are already doing deals over here. Before though, I got to do a couple of announcements. So if there's a Kurt Henry, he lost a bunch of ID cards there out at the back station, if you're around. Before I forget too, I also want to thank Ken over here as our video guy. I understand he's been doing this for like 15 years and does it for next to nothing. So thank you, Ken. Good man. All right. Well, I'm doing thank yous are our sponsors tonight. So Qualcomm Ventures, I mean, they are the consummate corporate citizen. Great folks. They do so much for San Diego. They gave us the venue tonight. Keith Muhart and his team, Quinn Lee, who is the head of the venture groups on our board, great folks. I thank them for all they do. TVC Capital, Jeb Spencer, Steve Hammerslag, great sponsors, good people. They're also in the midst of sponsoring a big study on software in San Diego. That report's supposed to be done in a month or so, and we're gonna use that data to help recruit engineers into San Diego, and we're gonna do a big push on that in the fall, so thank you to those guys. FusionX is a new fund in town that you may or may not have heard of, so I'm happy to announce that Ken Hood, who's the head of FusionX, has joined our board. FusionX is sort of a sidecar, loosely affiliated fund along with D&K Engineering, and you may know of D&K, they're the folks that do the design work and build the boxes for EcoATM. They built machines for Genprobe, Volcano, Illumina, an amazing place. So FusionX is sort of loosely attached to that group. Think of them as interested in sort of smart machines, but awesome to have some more money and a good guy and another fund in San Diego. I want to do a quick shout out to OSIC. They launched, They just launched their Kickstarter campaign at, I think, 1 a.m. this morning. And as of a couple of hours ago, they had exceeded their $100,000 goal. They're up to like $330,000. 3D headphones, really cool stuff. Kudos to the team there and the folks at Evo that helped get them going. Real quick, next month, three more VCs on stage talking about health tech, September 8th, Venture Summit. Mid-March, we're going to open up the apps for cool companies. And I just wanted to share this email that I got sort of unsolicited just a couple of days ago, ironically, you can read it. But I actually got a little bit choked up when it came to me because I think that's kind of why we're here and why we do what we do. But we got 30 companies. We brought down 35 VCs from the Valley, jammed them into a room for a couple hours. This guy got 600K. I know another company that's got about 2 million out of the relationships that he made at that event. So if you're a cool company or you know a cool company, I encourage you to get them to apply. Real quick, we added a bunch of new board members. Super excited about this group. If you know the folks on the list, some of the things we were trying to do with this list was to get a lot younger and get some millennials. We did that. We need some more younger people. we tried to get more diverse. I'm happy to say we got 7 women that are joining the board. Thank you. We wanted to get some people in Carlsbad because there's a ton of stuff going on up in Carlsbad. We did that. We got some corporates in Illumina and Viasat. We got some actual CEOs that are young and running active companies at present, so we can kind of hear from them, you know, what the issues are and what's going on. So super excited about this group, a ton of energy, and I thank them all for jumping on board. All right, so to today's speakers, I want to start by introducing David Coates up to the stage. David's a great guy. I've known him for a long time. He's got one of the coolest funds with a business model that's very different. I think it's genius. If it works out well and it's already going well, it's good for all of San Diego. He's probably the best syndicate partner there is for a VC. So he's got connections to a ton of folks. He's a data nut. He's gonna start us off with a bunch of info about the market and how San Diego fits into that market. So welcome, David. And now I'll invite the board up. Thanks, brother.
opportunity to present again this year on the state of the venture industry and some statistics on San Diego as well. I apologize if I sneeze halfway through this presentation. I hope I don't. So Correlation Ventures, briefly about us. We have $330 million under management. We invest across all industry sectors, all stages around the country. We're actually one of the most active venture investors in the country, making about 2 to 3 new investments a month. We're headquartered here in San Diego. We also have an office in Palo Alto. I've been a VC for a long time, about 18 years, believe it or not, and also been an entrepreneur raising venture capital and managing venture-funded companies, and came to the conclusion that the fundraising process is often way too time-consuming and distracting for management teams. And not just fundraising, but also managing investors on the boards of venture-funded companies. It takes an enormous amount of time, and you add it up over the life of a venture-funded company. It's amazing how much time it takes, and of course there's a trade-off. All the time spent on investor-related activities is time that otherwise could have been spent, you know, getting your next customer or whatever. When I was the lead investor, or somebody else was, I do think then important to be an industry expert, adding value with the board, doing classic due diligence. But once we got past 1 or 2 active VCs in almost every company where I've been involved, the last thing anyone often really wanted or needed for the next investor was another active VC at that point. So we often wanted then was professional, reliable investor, provide capital quickly without all the hassles and distractions. And so that's our mission at Correlation Ventures, is to be the dream co-investor to rapidly fill out a VC-led round. For example, we commit to make investment decisions within 2 weeks or less. We don't repeat any classic due diligence, automatically follow in future rounds, don't take board seats, for example. We're also known as, in case any of you have seen Moneyball or read Moneyball, many people call us the Moneyball Venture Capital because we're using predictive analytics to make these rapid co-investment decisions. So we've built what we believe is the most complete and accurate database of U.S. venture capital financings and their outcomes in the world. So we've spent many years and a lot of money building and maintaining and improving this data set. It has over 70,000 financings in it, including over 98% of all the VC financings that have occurred since 1987. So my presentation is going to primarily be focused on some findings on the industry and on San Diego that come out of our database. So the dark blue bars, the National Venture Capital Association reported that the U.S. venture capital industry raised about $28 billion last year, a little bit less than was raised in 2014 and less than we saw in 2006 and 2007. We estimate the light blue bars, the total amount of money that was invested into U.S. venture-funded companies last year was almost $70 billion. The most we've seen over the last decade by far. The difference between these two numbers is a large number of non-traditional investors who have come into this market, so hedge funds, private equity funds, international investors, et cetera. So what this graph plots is the amount of uncalled capital in the U.S. venture capital system each year going back to 1995. So specifically, the total amount of capital that venture funds, U.S. venture funds raised minus the amount that they had already called from their LPs. So it's a measure, some people call this the overhang in the U.S. venture market, the total amount of capital in the system. We shared data elsewhere showing a strong inverse correlation between the total amount of capital in the system and returns for all the financings in the venture industry that occurred that year. So the more money in the system, the lower the returns, less money in the system, higher the returns. This is an amazingly strong correlation going all the way back to 1995. So when I look at this graph, I find it encouraging with a note of caution. So encouraging in that although the amount of uncalled capital in the system has ticked up in the last couple of years, it's still low, relatively low by historical standards. So indicating that the most recent period has still been a relatively favorable period of time from the venture industry's perspective for generating attractive returns. However, the uptick in the last couple of years also indicates that the market has been heating up as well. And so that's the rest of my slides really focus on what's been happening here in the last couple of years. So where has this large amount of money I mentioned, you know, that flowed into the venture market, that was invested into venture-funded companies recently, where has that been going by industry sector in this case? And what we find is that the biggest increases in investment have been in the consumer services and business and financial services industries. I think that's partly because the fundamental changes in these industries and the internet and mobile that makes companies in these sectors more amenable to venture funding and for generating venture returns. You know, a couple examples from our portfolio, we have a company called Casper, which sells, you know, mattresses online through the mail. So it's hard to imagine 10 years ago, you know, an entirely e-commerce model could sell hundreds of millions of dollars worth of mattresses entirely through the mail. Or Earnest, which is doing loan, has $150 million a month in loan originations with an entirely online model, which would not have been possible, you know, 10 years ago. So I think that's part of the reason why these sectors have seen such big increases. This is by stage, so the percent of all the dollars invested into U.S. venture-funded companies in the U.S. venture industry by stage. And so what you see is the money has been increasingly flowing to later stage and away from early stage. So the red line, just as an example, those are, you know, Series D or later rounds. Back in 2006, it was 30% of all the money invested in venture-funded companies. Last year, it was 53%. In early stage, you can see the opposite, went from 22% to 13%. One caveat I should point out on all these 2015 numbers, these are extrapolated based on the first three quarters of the year, which is when I did these analyses, that's where the data set was updated as of. So that's a caveat on all these statistics, 2015 statistics. So San Diego County, so this, if you look at the light blue bars, this is the total amount of money invested into venture-funded San Diego-based companies per our estimates in our database each year. And so you see it's, even though it's dropped from 2006, 2007, but since then it's remained relatively constant. But as a share of the total venture industry, the dark blue line, it's declined just because during this time period, the amount of money being invested overall has increased significantly in the venture industry. So what this graph plots is the percent of all the dollars invested in San Diego companies which were in biopharmaceutical firms, and compares that to, that's the dark blue line, the light blue line is what percent of all the dollars invested in the venture industry were invested into biopharmaceutical firms. So as you can see, not surprising to folks in this ecosystem, we're much more heavily weighted to biopharma in San Diego than the industry by a long shot, and it looks like that increased last year. It'll be too early to tell whether that's a trend or whether that's just an anomaly, but you know, over half of all the dollars invested in the first three quarters of last year were in biopharmaceutical firms in San Diego. So if you look by stage, I thought this was actually, I'd expected San Diego to be more significantly overweighted to early stage versus the industry overall, and that's not what we find historically. Last year, I showed you, you know, the percent in the industry overall dropped significantly in early stage and increased in later stage. It looks like that did not occur in San Diego, that we stayed pretty constant as far as percent of dollars going to early stage. So this is a statistic that many in the industry are talking about, not surprisingly. You know, two measures of a market heating up are rising pre-money values and rising round sizes. They also, not surprisingly, correlate to lower returns for the industry. All else equal, higher prices. And this again is from the venture capitalist perspective. Entrepreneur's perspective, you can flip a lot of these conclusions. So what you see is that median pre-money values increased dramatically last year. Round size increased a little bit, but not nearly so dramatically as pre-money values. Now, one thing I will point out when I mentioned that it's extrapolated based on the first three quarters of the year, many of you may have seen an article on the front page of the Wall Street Journal reporting the fourth quarter statistics, saying that there was a dramatic drop in median pre-money value in the fourth quarter of last year, and others have reported that as well. So this could be, although it's too early, the Wall Street Journal was predicting this was the start of the hangover for venture industry and that this would be a persistent trend. I think too early to say that conclusively, but potentially good news for the venture industry's perspective. So where have the pre-money values been rising? This is by stage. Turns out across all stages. So it wasn't unique to just later stage, although the later stage valuations obviously increased most dramatically. But still, on a percentage basis, even the early stage is a pretty significant change in pre-money value over the last year. Now this, I don't have San Diego data to present on pre-money value. It's, frankly, just wasn't confident presenting it because the numbers are small enough where not confident in the conclusions. Preliminarily, though, when I look at it, it looks like pre-money values have been rising in San Diego, but did not. Last year, they stayed relatively constant with the caveat of small numbers. So one thing we focus on a lot at Correlation, not surprisingly internally, is characterizing empirically where the winners really are in venture, by many metrics. What this graph or this table shows is where the winners have been concentrated in terms of stage, round size, and pre-money value. So if you look at all the VC exits in the industry that occurred over the last 5 years, 2011 to 2015, over 62% of all the dollars invested that realized a 10x or greater cash-on-cash multiple in those exits were in seed to Series B rounds. Two-thirds were in rounds with a round size less than 20 million, and 56% were in rounds with a pre-money value less than 25 million. So, and this is disproportionate to dollars, as I showed you a minute ago. So disproportionately, the winners are in these early stage, small round sizes, lower pre-money value rounds. So majority of the winners are in seed to Series B stage rounds. Where do a majority of the industry dollars, where have they gone in the last 5 years? So majority of the venture industry dollars go to later stage, even though most of the winners are concentrated in the other area. Similarly, by round size, majority of the winners are in financings with a round size less than 20 million. Majority of the industry dollars go into these larger round sizes. And finally, pre-money value. So majority of the winners are in financings with a pre-money value less than 25 million. Majority of the industry dollars go in very high pre-money value rounds. This statistic amazed me when I first saw it, the fact that almost two-thirds of all the dollars invested in the U.S. venture industry over the past 5 years were in financings with a round size 100 million or more. Well, that's it. I appreciate the opportunity to provide you an overview of the U.S. venture industry and a few statistics on San Diego as well.
Good job. Thank you, sir. You got the last. Okay, we're going to shove David over into the last seat and we'll invite our other panelists up. Really excited. We've got these guys. We got Seed Series A, we got Series B, we got a LifeSci guy. Great folks. I want to say a few words about our moderator, John Belmonte. I've known John for a long time. Super good guy. How he's always available, I have no idea. He's got four kids. Maybe he just wants out of the house, but I don't think so. spent a lot of time at active.com where they raised over 100 million bucks. One of the most prolific acquirers of companies. John led the taking back the company private and then the sell to a PE firm for over $1 billion. But what I like most is he spends a lot of time giving back to the entrepreneurs in San Diego, so he's the perfect guy to grill this panel tonight. Thank you, guys.
Great.
All yours.
Thanks very much, Mike. So what we're hoping to do is we've got some experts from a variety of different areas of the venture capital industry. We've got B2B covered, we've got the consumer market covered, we've got life sciences covered, small, mid-stage and then later stage companies. So really what I want to do in my job is just to ask good questions, try to facilitate some conversation, and you know, see if I can get these folks to mix it up a little bit. Hopefully we'll open it up to questions later. So with that, I'll ask you to introduce yourselves, if you don't mind. So Bob, maybe you could start. And then, so maybe just a quick introduction, and then we'll circle back with the first question after that.
Great. So Bob Belterra, up here, it says Frazier, but I want to disappoint all my life science friends in the room. I'm an entrepreneur in residence there. I'm not actively looking to make investments for Frazier. And on the flip side, I've been co-opted with some of my colleagues to seek out some assets around which to build a company, which we would manage. But obviously, we're very closely tied, and it doesn't stop the opportunity for finding some interesting life science opportunities that we take to them for broader consideration. But that's not my primary mandate.
Right. But you clearly bring the CEO perspective as well,
sure.
Having raised lots of money, exited companies,
yes.
You know, whatnot.
Yeah.
So that's great. CAC?
I'm Kak Wilhelm. I came down from San Francisco today. I'm with Scale Venture Partners. We're focused exclusively on B2B, so enterprise software. I think of it as enterprise, not consumer, software, not hardware. Everything app layer, infrastructure layer, and down. We'll consider data center, but less so. And luckily, after those slides, we're in that green line, mid-stage. Early stage to
mid,
but not the late stage. Otherwise, I'd have some explaining to do.
Great, thanks. Brian?
Sure, I'm Brian Garrett, came down from LA today. We are a Southern California-focused seed fund, started back in 2008, doing primarily first institutional capital into a whole plethora of opportunities and ideas that the Southern California ecosystem has been producing. We just announced our third fund in June of last year at $75 million. And sort of sweet spot is writing million, million and a half check, first bite size, and then following on over subsequent rounds. Across the gamut, but capital efficient businesses, not really hardware centric, not deep infrastructure, more consumerization of IT, B2B SaaS, and direct to consumer e-com.
Great.
Mobile gaming, et cetera.
Excellent. And you know, David, at this point. Okay, so there's, you know, hopefully there's a lot of things that we are not going to agree upon, but I think there's a couple of things that we can agree upon. Within the venture capital realm, while VC is not predictable, it is somewhat cyclical, right? So things heat up, things get overheated, things cool off, often in a fairly dramatic fashion, things stabilize, they heat up, they overheat, right? So I think we can definitely agree upon that. I think the second thing that we can agree upon is venture capital is merely one facet of our overall kind of financial ecosystem. So there's lots of things that influence the venture capital cycle. So it might be the public markets, it might be the economy, it might be public mood, I mean, who knows? So, you know, maybe Brian, we could start with you. I mean, what's your take? You know, there's two schools of thought out there, right? One is, you know, things are heating up. You saw the numbers, you know, from David. The industry is very active. The last couple of years have been great, particularly from a company and from an entrepreneur standpoint. And I think they've been good from a venture capital standpoint. I guess time will tell. So, you know, things are good, and we probably still have another couple of years of that. On the flip side, you know, in the immortal words of Ned Stark, winter is coming. And in the maybe not quite as immortal words of Mark Suster, winter has come. So what's your take on where we stand? And, you know, what do you think 2016 holds for venture capital, for companies, as well as for VCs?
Yeah, so I guess we feel like we're probably the most insulated from the macroeconomic factors that are affecting venture financing cycles. What we do, you know, our pre-money values fluctuate slightly. And so our framework has always been innovation doesn't stop looking at the level of the Dow or NASDAQ. Entrepreneurs are going to continue to think of creative ideas and go after it. And our job is to sort of stay steady and continue to catalyze innovation in the SoCal ecosystem. So that's been our mantra, marching orders, since we started this fund. And the truth was, we started this in August of 2008 is when we raised our first $5 million fund, put two deals to work, thought we'd raise more money, kind of overextended ourselves on first check, and then went, oh shit, there's no more money out there to raise as a venture fund, what are we gonna do? And it ended up being a phenomenal fund because angels went away, prices came down, and we were sort of the only guys in town.
Yep.
Staying consistent with this idea that, hey, innovation isn't gonna stop. Back the most passionate entrepreneurs with the best ideas and fight. And to the credit of those entrepreneurs, they did, and it ended up being a great portfolio. So I think our framework is that, and we just said this to our LPs at our LP meeting 2 weeks ago, it's a return to normal. And we ended up not putting a lot of money to work in the second half of last year after we had raised our fund, because we just felt valuations were out of whack, even at the early stages. And again, what's out of whack? 12 million pre instead of 6 million pre. Arguably, if it's a big successful business, that doesn't matter, but to the data, it does. And we've seen it over time, that being disciplined on price and size of rounds and quality of co-investors really matters long-term in this business. So for us, it's business as usual. I think the bar is a little higher to attract what's called a seed round in today's market, but I think that it'll be actually a fantastic year for venture firms. And the tide has shifted a little bit to be more venture friendly in terms of the terms and the control and the leverage in the deals than maybe we've seen over the last 4 or 5 years.
Okay. Kat, so do you think, to Brian's point, I mean, do you think that as entrepreneurs or as companies, should folks be worried? I mean, is venture capital drying up, like a lot of folks are saying, or is it a return to normal, like Brian's saying?
Yeah, so there are a lot of questions in there. I mean, I think you have seen...
I'm trying to confuse
ton,
you.
Yeah, you've seen a ton of venture funds announce raises, fundraises, their own funds, as in LPs putting money into venture firms. Even just January and February, Battery just announced today, $950 million. We just announced a few weeks ago, $335 million. Bunch of firms are announcing funds. Granted, they raised those last fall, so it was good timing. Scale's happy that we raised ours last fall. So it is, there's a 10-year cycle between going out to the LPs and getting them to commit money, and then actually you have this capital overhang that David was talking about. It takes a while to actually deploy that capital. So I don't think the money coming into venture is gonna dry up anytime soon, and if it is, it's gonna be a long lag from today. That said, as you said, you know, innovation's not going anywhere. There are going to be great companies that come out of today, tomorrow, yesterday, regardless of the market landscape versus the tech landscape. That said, if I were an entrepreneur and I were burning a crazy amount of money that I can't justify, I would be worried. And some of that is on the venture investors, because I think we have pushed, we want extreme growth. That's what we're buying. But we want growth at a profit, we don't want growth at all costs. And I think in 2015, you saw growth at all costs, you know, hog wild, spend money, and you were trading off growth for profit instead of growth to perpetuate running a business faster, getting bigger faster, commanding a presence, cornering the market, being first mover, and being the next big guy. That's what I'd worry about.
Great. So, Bob, I think both Brian and CAC's perspective is largely from a what I'd call a technology perspective. What do you think from a life sciences standpoint? I mean, same, different, where are we in the cycle?
A little bit different, I would say. The life sciences venture community, the garden was weeded about four or five years ago. Prior to that, let's say 2000, there were lots of venture capitalists running around in the life science space. Driven by a robust IPO market. Because remember, in our business, I'll be lucky, I'm 50, I'll be lucky if I start on a project today and I get to see sales of it before I pushing daisies. hopefully, I'm not that old yet. But you know, it's a 15-year cycle, honestly. By the time a good scientist has an idea to you're generating sales, it's 15 years. So there's fewer life sciences VCs today than there were 10 years ago, and their funds are smaller, and I think that's good, both good and bad. And it's good in the sense that I think a lot of projects were funded in the mid-2000s and early 2000s that didn't warrant didn't warrant the type of funding they got. They were really science projects rather than drug development projects that tainted the whole industry. And consequently, the IPO market in the life sciences space went away for a very, very, very long time. It came back in the last 2 years, but it's closed right now. And that, I think I tend to believe we are back to the more normalcy in life sciences than we were, let's say, in the 2000s.
Excellent. David, just going back to the data that you presented, I couldn't help but look at the data, and particularly at the end of the presentation, and think, gee, it seems like a lot of money went into very promising potential unicorns, so to speak, several years ago. Some of them played out the way folks had hoped, and there's been massive, massive follow-up rounds to those companies, which has driven the percentage of capital going into, you know, over $100 million pre-money valuation companies. So do we think that the unicorns have sort of moved through the proverbial python? I don't know if you can make that analogy. It's probably good there's no kids here, actually. But do you know what I'm saying? Like, do you think, I guess the question to you is, has that kind of skewed the data to some degree and made it seem that there's a flight towards larger deals? Why do you think that would be?
Well, I think part of what happened is that you have these non-traditional investors who have invested a lot of capital into venture-funded companies, and they have different return goals and expectations. So, you know, we're quite a few companies where the investors are putting a lot of money in these high valuations, and they're saying, if I get a 2x, I'm really happy.
Right.
And that's not what the typical venture model is. So you have a bunch of investors, a whole different set of risk-return, you know, objectives, which I think has in part driven that. The other fact I think is, you know, people think of the venture industry as this one monolithic beast, right? And in fact, it's made up of all sorts of different segments, venture firms, geographies, stages, which all behave differently. You know, so there's correlations, but they, you know, medical devices, for example, has been, you know, the opposite dynamic from what we're seeing here for quite a few years. You know, the valuations have been low, very difficult to raise money,
right,
et cetera. And you know, when you look historically, kind of measures of sectors heating up, and you know, we track that pretty closely, they don't all move together at all. So you find, you look at, they are crossing all the time. So what happened in the last few years, I think, is just, it's been amazing. The sectors that where a lot of money has gone in have all also been heating up a lot, and so it's driving these numbers. But it's mostly in the consumer, the services companies, which are really driving all these numbers.
So are you investing against the trend lines? Are you going into sectors that are out of vogue and going the opposite of the curves?
So we are overweighted to sectors which are opposite. Yeah, but the reality is within any sector, you know, there are a whole bunch of different opportunities. And so within any sector, empirically, there are a lot of great opportunities. It's just in a heated sector, you have to be that much more careful. If you did an index of that sector, you wouldn't do well.
Right.
But if you pick well, you can still do well. That's so.
Interesting. Keck, let me ask you a question. I mean, just to build on that, you know, again, we raised a couple of $1 million a year and a half ago, and I vividly remember spending time with certain investors saying, gee, I'm not getting that warm and fuzzy feeling because I just don't see you as a unicorn. And I don't think it really had very much to do with, candidly, I don't think it had a lot to do with what the opportunity with our company was. It had much more to do with the approach that we were taking, right? Our approach was much more, nope, we're going to have revenue from day one. We don't want to raise $10 million right now and then go throw it up against the wall and see what happens. We're going to take a lot more, I don't know if it's conservative or practical approach. But I kept hearing like unicorn, unicorn, unicorn. Do you think that's still the case now? Do you think are most venture capital firms looking for that fund maker, that unicorn, or do you think there's more of kind of a scaling back?
Yeah, I was hoping we'd get through the night without talking about unicorns, but we have failed.
You should have like a drinking thing going on.
Right,
with unicorns.
Yeah.
You see, I avoided it. He asked, tried to ask.
Yes, right. Billion-dollar valuations. Well, the unicorn idea is preaching the wrong thing, because valuations shouldn't be what matters. And the problem with the unicorns is, you know, in order to justify the ownerships, then you're raising so much money. And I think raising so much money is fine if you're building Magic Leap and there's a huge R&D effort and it requires a lot of money. The problem is when you see, I don't know if down here you guys have Munchery and Sprig and every food delivery known to man, and those are super capital intensive businesses. And so when you're piling money and burning money and growing at all costs to, you know, perpetuate this unicorn billion-dollar valuation thing, then the whole system's screwed up. I do think, you know, at the different stages, people are interested in seeing different things. Billion-dollar, if not in terms of valuations, just in terms of market size, is a very credible, rational thing to be looking for. I mean, everyone wants there to be a very efficient model serving a big market, you know, big horizontal market, not verticalized, where ultimately it can be the fund winner, and naturally everyone would be very interested in that. So I think unicorns sometimes can be a proxy for this is going to be our fund winner, but I think if it's too focused on the valuation as opposed to the potential for extreme outcome, then you're going in the wrong direction. And I can't believe I'm defending the late stage investors, but I do think the data is totally accurate and you're spot on. And you just alluded to this, but some of these late stage guys like the Fidelities and T. Rowe's and Wellingtons that are, they're coming at it from such a different angle. And for them, instead of buying at the IPO, they rationally thought that if they could only buy in the latest stage round, they might get a price discount. Well, in fact, as we're seeing, you know, 35 of the last 48 tech IPOs are underwater. So maybe that rational decision wasn't so smart. But I think they're coming at it from the right idea, which is if we can get a quick 2x, it's a good move. Whereas the early stage guys like you guys, you want everything to be a 10x or zero, you know, get out of the.
But we have never actually used the word unicorn in Crosscut's office. And I think part of it is a Southern California
dragon?
Cultural
thing. Have you used the
thing?
Term dragon?
No.
Yeah. I just read about that today, actually.
We try to stay away from that. But the point I'm trying to make here is that I think, and this is part of the culture of Southern California, so I am bucketing LA and San Diego. We come from a much scrappier framework of company building and entrepreneurship, and we think about things in just rational milestones that you try to achieve that create value, perceived value or not. And so our framework is, yeah, we want a 10x minimum, and the only time we think about unicorn-style things is just in thinking about market size and potential of the business, not will this thing be valued at a billion? Because to David's data, where do all the exits happen, right? The history of venture is driven off of, I don't know if this is accurate anymore, but like 80% of the exits are between $20 and $120 million, right? And so it really, it's what started this entire micro venture framework and the barbell nature of where LPs are allocating dollars. They're either putting them into the top 10, you know, 500, $1.5 billion funds in the valley that see every unicorn, or they're putting them into sub $150 million funds that all have that return profile.
That makes sense. Bob, same question on the life sciences side. I mean, life sciences, to my knowledge, kind of has a reputation of, you know, really going after the big winners.
Well, it's a little, well, one thing I've learned tonight, I live in a different world, right, than these guys live in.
Clearly you live in the right world.
Yeah, well, I don't know about that. That part's true. Now, I think, you know, I was thinking about this and, you know, the phenomenon that we've seen in the last few years in life sciences was the opening of the IPO market, which had been closed for 10 years, essentially. Mm-hmm. So the unique challenge in our business is, you know, we run experiments in human beings. The data never comes out the way you, if you sit down and write your expectation, never comes out the way you hope. If your probably best case scenario is, looks good, but we have some other questions to address, and incredibly capital intensive, right? So running, you know, if I put together a clinical trial, you know, budget to take an asset from benchtop all the way through FDA approval, and launch in a disease like NASH, which is one of the hot unicorn diseases that we're looking at now. That's somewhere,
I'm gonna have to tweet that.
$300-400 million of investment, if not more.
Wow.
To commercialize it. And we sell, and the exits in our business primarily have been either I can convince the public markets this is a special area, we're going to cure NASH, which if you don't know what that is, it's a Western culture epidemic disease now. It's fatty liver disease. It's an inflammatory fibrosis disease of the liver, frankly driven by Western diet. Who gets it? Typically people who are poor, can't afford a healthy diet, single moms, McDonald's dinner four or five times a week, and this is what they end up with. And you're seeing children with it's the obesity epidemic, and it's now playing in these certain situations. So I think the challenge is, but I live and my brethren live in a highly regulated environment. We must appease the FDA, and that's the way it should be, I believe. And then once that's done, we have to go appease payers, we have to go appease physicians and patients, right? So it's not a flashy commercial during the Super Bowl. It's a lot of really constructing the whole picture, and it's capital intensive. I do, and where I've lived in my companies, the way I approach it and Fraser approaches it, we try to get in a focused approach, typically on one or two assets, put smartly developed clinical trial design where a meaningful endpoint, the answer could be no. My last company was a no. The answer could be a yes, and transact on that, and frankly, hand it off to the industry, the pharma industry, who at the same time, and I think this is healthy, is getting out of the earlier stage research.
Right.
And they're looking to buy. Hey, Bolterra, if you fail, you're out of a job. I don't got to lay off, half 300 people in Cambridge because I can't make my numbers this quarter, which is what they're sick of doing that. So I think you're seeing some of that dynamic occurring. But there are a few, I would say, unicorns, but they tend to be realized in the public markets rather than the private VC market in the biotech space. It's when they go public and they're walking around with two, three, and they're bought for $7 billion, which has happened here recently,
right,
in San Diego, of a company that was private in the biotech space, Receptos, then went public and was purchased for $7.5 billion. And I know I can tell you, I lived at Amgen for many years. I could have never got to that calculation to pay that much for that company, ever. Hmm. But that's our business, and the dirty secret in the biotech pharma business is you almost can't justify the valuation of any big pharma company or big biopharma company out there right now. Can't do the math.
Okay. So let's shift gears a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about San Diego. I'd particularly like to get your impression as the money. So Keck, how many deals, have you looked at a lot of deals in San Diego? Have you put much money to work down here? And kind of what's your perspective on San Diego in terms of, its assets, its drawbacks, its whatnot?
Yeah, so I'd say our actions in this case don't speak louder than our words, because we haven't invested as a firm scale, we haven't invested down here we haven't done very many deals. We look at stuff, but we haven't done anything recently. And I think appetite for San Diego, you can deconstruct it to two things. There's the one, which is the partner time management, which is really insignificant, but it's the partner sits on 10 boards. If they're local, it's quicker. You just go over to the company, especially if it's earlier stage, you have more touch points, it's easier. That said, San Diego is an hour away. It's not Charlottesville, Virginia, where it's a two-hop flight and it takes you 2 days. So I would deem that a total non-factor. The second is the ecosystem, which we talked about a little bit beforehand. I am not the arbiter of whether this is a good ecosystem or a great ecosystem. You guys know that. I do think the more exits you guys have and the more people that stay, and the Facebook fellow that you were saying, one of the early employees who's now done some seed investments, the stronger the ecosystem, the more accelerators and such will just make a stronger, more viable climate for great companies to emerge. I also think with the market in the not so great place that it is right now, and people focus heavily on burn, there is something to be said for if you can get great employees, you can keep talent here, you can rent space for, I'm sure, less than half of what it costs in San Francisco right now. There's a strong argument, maybe it's not the main office, but there's an office here, or so there are probably economic arguments for San Diego being great. So I mean, going forward, we're very open to San Diego companies. We've met a few, Harvest AI, I don't know if they're here, but keen on our radar, cybersecurity company doing well. Who knew, you know, no one said they can't be in San Diego. So we're open, no reason not to.
Well, Brian, what's your take? I know you guys have looked at a bunch of stuff down here. What's your take? And also, what's your take on the difference between San Diego, LA? You know, how do folks in San Diego access the LA market?
Yeah. So back in 2001, when I started as a VC, there was so much happening down here that I contemplated moving my family on behalf of the fund I was working with out of LA to cover the San Diego market. That was 01 to 05. And then I started Crosscut in 2008. As I mentioned, our very first deal was an Encinitas company called Verve Mobile. And then really had not a lot of inbound deal flow and not a lot pulling me down here, partly because so much was happening in LA during that time frame. But partly just because we didn't find a lot of compelling stuff to come down here in our sweet spot. And now I would say I have, in the last 2 months, feel like kind of the floodgates are opening up again, and I met a bunch of really interesting businesses earlier today that, you know, got me out of LA early and came down to see and sit down. So I do think I see a lot of similarities, a lot of parallels. I think there's a couple things lacking here that really LA benefited from, which was primarily Mark Suster in the 08, 09, you know, and beyond timeframe. Someone that would get on the soapbox and do the look at me, look at me, look at me thing.
Yeah.
You need that. You need the successes of your ecosystem to create attention and draw people down. You need accelerator and incubator infrastructure, whether they're good or bad. When we raised Fund 2 in 2012, we were pointing to almost 20 accelerator incubators in the greater LA area that had all popped up in the last 18 months. Fast forward now, most of them are dead. They didn't work. Their business models didn't work for whatever reason. But our point of view was, who cares? It was great for the ecosystem, right? It just gave more entrepreneurs a shot on goal to try to figure out how to bring scale and repeatability to their business, and we sat on the other side as the Switzerland of that ecosystem, kind of cherry picking. And so I don't know how well established that is down here, but all of those things really benefited LA to the point now where it's arguably the second most active ecosystem in the country and in the world. So I see a lot of parallels. I would say quality of life, talent, all those things that you have down here that we were taking advantage of. And now, I don't know if it's happening down here, but I get probably one resume a week of a third-time successful Silicon Valley entrepreneur saying I'm starting my next thing in LA for quality of life. Hmm. And I've sort of had it with everything the Valley represents. And I'm like, keep it coming. Love it.
Hmm. You should send some of them a little bit down the 405 towards us.
Keep going.
They'll be here in 10 years, I'm sure,
yeah.
When they get sick of LA.
Exactly.
Yeah, no, I just to build on that point, I mean, I've kind of been beating this drum. I don't know if I've been doing a lot about it, but I've been beating this drum, and we talked about this earlier. I mean, I think one of the big challenges that San Diego has is it's a laid-back community. And that doesn't mean people don't work hard, doesn't mean that there, you know, not lots of aggressive, you know, folks here in town and really, you know, quote unquote going for it. But we've had a lot of wins. We've had a lot of big outcomes as companies. And you know, but as a community, we're pretty terrible at standing up and taking credit for them, right? So, yeah, I mean, Active was again, there's a lot of hair on that deal, but, you know, it was a pretty good sizable deal. Like, no one would really equate that deal with San Diego. Or GoFundMe, you know, had a really nice outcome last year. And, you know, we were talking about that earlier, and, you know, everyone scratches their head at the fact that that's a San Diego company. And I could, you know, list 5 or 10 or 15 of those. But I think sometimes our laid-backness and our non-sisterness, if that's a word, I think that really hurts us in terms of a community. So anyway, I think that's definitely something to consider, and we've kind of called that out. And I know San Diego Venture Group is doing a lot on that front, and really getting behind that effort. So
I'm from Minneapolis, and I try to go back. There are some startup demo days, and I try to go back and look at the companies. And maybe it's sort of like San Diego, where so many companies are bootstrapped, and so many co-founding teams aren't ready to leave their company. They're still doing their full-time job and they're doing it on the side. And you kind of have to prod them and say, you have something great. You already have, you have more revenue than lots of these Series A companies raising in San Francisco. You just have to go forth and try.
Right.
Even come to San Francisco or New York, Boston, LA and try to raise funding. But I think sometimes people need to be reminded that you have something great and you don't just need your buddy to fund it. You could actually go get legit funding.
Cool. How are we doing on time, Mike?
3 minutes.
3 minutes. I could tell a joke, but that would not. Yeah, I was going to say, why don't we can go down the line, and if folks have closing remarks, a story, an anecdote, something that, I think kind of. What's that?
Prediction.
Ah, okay. So, Mr. Data, what's your prediction for 2016 in terms of where the total amount of money is going to land? So from a quantitative standpoint, and then qualitatively, do you think we're going to continue to, things will continue to be hot this year and into 2017? Or do you think they're going to, drop off?
I mean, if you look historically at the patterns, as you talked about initially, the industry is cyclical, clearly. So you have this dynamic where the industry raises a bunch of money, valuations go up just because of the supply-demand, returns go down, people get nervous, the amount of capital gets lower in the industry, returns then go up. It's happened several times. And so you can, fairly confidently predict that whether it's next year or the year after that, I can't predict, but it sure does seem like industry-wide, we are likely on the, turning to a cooling of the industry as far as lower pre-money values, smaller round sizes, more capital-efficient companies, and probably lower average exit values for a while too. But I actually think the fundamentals are strong. The industry has changed so fundamentally as far as the amount of capital it takes to start a business, test an idea. There's a lot of strong fundamentals in this industry. So I agree that I'd see it going back to kind of a normal, as was said earlier.
Brian, I'm going to throw in a twist there also. So I'd love you to answer the same question, but I'm also curious how you think the it being an election year is going to impact that. And feel free to layer in who you support.
No. I
peg you as a Trump guy.
Definitely not. I have sworn that I'm moving my family to Australia if I'm president. So I think the layer that I lay on top of that is really, the advice that you hear the VCs giving their entrepreneurs right now is cut burn, make cash last, raise as much as you can. And we feel very lucky. We took 14 companies to market last year and raised $500 million for them. And thank God we did, right? In so many ways. Like, they're overcapitalized. They're probably at valuations they don't deserve. But I'll take that over not having cash on the balance sheet. What I think is going to happen, I think the VCs are actually the litmus. So I can name 15 funds that are going out to raise their next fund now with a dry close, meaning they will not deploy it. And they're doing it because the LPs haven't caught up on the changes that are happening. And so they're going to take advantage and get that commitment now, even though they don't need it. And so that means there's still going to be a lot of money in the system. And at the end of the day, these are greed-driven partnerships that need to put the money to work to, believe they can get returns, capture their managed, all these things. So things will slow down, but things will not be nearly as dramatic as these other corrections we've seen. And I think deal pace will still be consistent. I just think the bar is a little bit higher on what you need to achieve with your previous dollars. And I was saying today, I saw two companies today doing north of 100K in MRR for a SaaS business. And 9 months ago, that would have attracted a $5 million A round from Silicon Valley at a 15 to 20 million pre. And I don't think that's gonna happen anymore. I think those are more like seed stage deals that will go raise and successfully raise 3 million bucks. So it's a changing tide, but again, the bar just moves in these cycles. It doesn't burn down, or some analogy you want. Unicorn through a cobra, whatever.
Yeah, the only thing, I agree. I think in general, it will be tempered enthusiasm this year. On new funds, I think you're right. Any established fund will be able to raise more money. I wouldn't want to be going out to raise my own CAC Wilhelm fund this year. I don't think anyone has the appetite for new GPs particularly. And the only prediction I'll make, I do think there will, some great companies will get out with IPOs this year. It may be a overall slower year than in the past, but there are probably 5, 10, 15 great, and this is on the tech side, enterprise tech side, but there are some great companies that have all the fundamentals that ought to be able to go public. And in a window of opportunity, I think there will be some good IPOs this year.
So we're different.
I haven't picked up on that, yeah.
I'll say the following. I love meeting a guy who loves greed but hates Trump. That's interesting. But anyway, no, just a joke.
Yeah.
I think it's an election year. Just like, when you think back in the 90s, there was a saying, the Serbs and the Croats can't agree on too much, but they agree on shooting the guy in the baby blue helmet. Democrats, Republicans don't agree on much, but they'll blame pharmaceutical industry for the nation's woes. That's happening. The result of that will be the IPO market will remain shut to biotech and pharma companies, biopharma companies. So if you're in the later stage, if you've raised a lot of money and you're eating a lot, you're in trouble. A and B rounds, and the good news though is the flip side is the VCs in the biopharma space have raised new capital. They have a lot of money to deploy. They will be deploying a lot of money in the A rounds and B follow-on rounds. So you'll see a lot of that happening, I believe. I think the one major difference though, you'll see that in the past, the old model of venture capital in biotech of grab a couple scientists out of Scripps and we'll put money in and we won't put any management in and just let them do science and cool things. Those days are done. You're going to see a lot more of marrying up those sort of skillful people with a lot more seasoned executives and really carefully managing the cash burn, driving to definitive endpoints and trying to transact. And I believe while the exits won't be in the IPO space, you will see a lot of them. I think M&A will start picking up in the biotech space, which has been slow in the last few years due to the hot IPO market.
Great. All right, so I'm gonna turn things back over to Mike, but I wanted to thank all four of our esteemed panelists, and particularly Brian and Kat for coming down, spending time with us.
So if you follow Belmonte on Facebook, you can figure out who he's voting for in the next election.
No, I make fun of everybody. I'm an equal opportunity basher.
It's great. One comment, because you asked a really good question about perception of San Diego, which I loved it, because when you overlaid David's data on top of that, I think it's interesting and good news that you've got CAC down here looking at a San Diego company, Harvest AI. Brian's down here looking at deals. I've had 4 calls with different VCs in the last 2 weeks. The general consensus is always the same. It's valuations are too high in the Valley, our engineers jump around too much. So it bodes well for San Diego. They won't come down here and hunt like these two for the most part, but if we take the good deals and drop ship them in their laps, I think there's a good road ahead. So we're working on doing that. And thank you guys again for coming out.
Great.
All right, we're out. Thank you all. Bar's still open.